Hare Krishna, here we go again with the 16th episode of the Daily Bhagavata Mirror. And we start the whole session, with a short Jaya Radha Madhava. Jaya Radha Madhava. Jaya Kunja Bihari, Jaya Radha Madhava, Jaya Kunja Bihari, Jaya Gopi Jana Vallabha, Jaya Vasudevaya, Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya, Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya, Narayanam Namaskritya Naram Chaiva Narottamam, Devim Sarasvatim Vyasam Tato Jayam Udhirayat, Nashta Prayeshva Bhatreshu Nityam Bhagavata Sevaya, Bhagavatyuttama Shloke, Bhaktya Bhavati Naishtiki. So, welcome to another episode of the Daily Bhagavata Mirror. We are reading today from the 11th canto, chapter 8, and this is called The Story of Pingala, text number 13. I somehow missed text 13 and 14 yesterday and jumped over to verse 15. And a good friend of mine notified me. So we certainly have to read those verses too. So the Sanskrit goes like Padapi. Where's my glasses? My glasses. Here. Padapi yuatan vikshur na sprishit tarat vimapi sprishan kariva badyeta harinya angasangataha. A saintly person should never touch a young girl. In fact, he should not even let his foot touch a wooden doll in the shape of a woman. By bodily contact with a woman, he will surely be captured by illusion, just as the elephant is captured by the she-elephant due to his desire to touch her body. Quite intense shloka. Purport. Elephants are captured in the jungle in the following way. A large hole is dug and then covered over with grass, leaves and mud and so on. Then a she-elephant is exhibited in front of the male elephant, who chases after her with lusty desire, fall into the hole and is captured. The lesson to be learned from the elephant is that the desire to relish the touch sensation is certainly the cause of ruining one's life. An intelligent person, noting the elephant's great propensity to sport with the she-elephant, will take this excellent example to heart. Therefore, somehow or other, one should avoid being cheated by allurement to the sensuous form of women. One should not allow one's mind to be lost in lusty dreams of sex pleasure. There are various types of sense gratification to be enjoyed between men and women, including speaking, contemplating, touching, sexual intercourse, etc. And all of these constitute the network of illusion by which one is helplessly bound like an animal. Somehow or other, one should remain aloof from sense gratification in the form of sex pleasure. Otherwise, there is no possibility of understanding the spiritual world. Again, the verse. A saintly person should never touch a young girl. In fact, he should not even let his foot touch a wooden doll in the shape of a woman. By bodily contact with a woman, he will surely be captured by illusion, just as the elephant is captured by the she-elephant due to his desire to touch her body. Om Ajnana Timirandasya Gyananjana Shalakaya Chakshu Unmilitam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha. So, yes, the Srimad Bhagavatam is famous for, we say in German, is not, man redet nicht um den heißen Brei herum. The Bhagavatam is not talking or, I think, beating about the bush is the idiom, the English idiom. It is not talking around a very important topic, but it comes to the point. And here again we have one of those verses that is touching our nerve, I think, because we all are somehow, the conditioned soul originally came into this spiritual world to imitate the Supreme Lord Sri Krishna. And as we know, there are five rasas, right? Five loving exchanges between God and the living entity, and also amongst the living entities. And it starts with the Shanta rasa, the neutral relationship. Then one level higher is the relationship between a servant and a master. Then the next one is brotherly or sisterly, I don't know if this word exists, brotherly, sisterly relationship, or the rasa of friendship, of equal friendship. When we have friends who are on the same platform as we are, we have a friendly relationship. There is not so much officiality, awe and reverence, we say. So then the next one, the fourth one, is the relationship between parents and their children, or vice versa, the relationship between children and their parents. So there is a unique taste or experience in this relationship. It is called Vatsalya Rasa. So, and the fifth and highest one ist die so-called Madhurya Rasa. Madhurya Rasa means the loving exchange between a man and a woman, or a boy and a girl, in the more erotic. It has more this erotic character between husband and wife, or loved and beloved and lover. So yeah, that is the Madhurya Rasa. So we can consider this Madhurya Rasa as the highest, because all the other rasas, the rasas Shanta Rasa, Dasya Rasa, the relationship between a master and a servant, the brotherly or sisterly or rasa of friendship called Sakya Rasa, and also even the Vatsalya Rasa, the parental rasa, it is somehow included in this highest Madhurya Rasa. Because sometimes a husband has to be like a father to his spouse. For instance, sometimes the wife is sick, then the husband has to treat her like a doctor. Now you have to take your medicine, or vice versa. Sometimes I have seen the wife is treating her husband like a mother. Did you get breakfast? And have you drank your tea? And so on. So sometimes men and women in the conjugal relationship, they treat each other as in the form as mother and father. Sometimes this may happen. And sometimes they have a friendship, a relationship that is very basic, based on friendship. So, and sometimes the wife serves the husband like a menial servant, and vice versa. Sometimes the husband serves the wife like a servant. So therefore, in the Madhurya Rasa, all these other four rasas or exchanges are somehow included. But there is something in the Madhurya Rasa, in the conjugal or erotic rasa, we don't find them, or we don't find it in neither in the parental exchange, parental relationship, nor in the relationship of two friends, nor in the relationship of the servant and the master, and also not in the neutral rasa. We don't find this. If we find an erotic aspect in the relationship between a child and a mother or a father, then something is wrong, or between friends. That disturbs, that can even highly disturb the relationship. But in the conjugal Madhurya Rasa, all these other exchanges and experiences are included. So therefore, this Madhurya Rasa is considered the highest rasa, and in the moment when the soul turns away from Krishna in the spiritual world and wants to imitate Krishna here in this temporary material world, then also this Madhurya Rasa, this erotic rasa, is considered the highest rasa here. But at the same time, this experience of this sexual exchange is also the cause of binding oneself very tightly to the material concept of life. The more we dive into the sensual sexual relationship, the more we are captured here in the material world. That means we have to again take birth here, again and again and again, because this sexual attachment is so strong. And Krishna explains in the Bhagavad Gita that what we are thinking about or meditating about at the time of death, this determines our next life, our next birth, our next body. So most often a man is thinking about women at the time of death, maybe about his wife, and vice versa, the woman is thinking about, the wife is thinking about the husband, or some relationship she had with man, and vice versa, if some the man is thinking about relationships he had with women, because that was the strongest activities. The most of our attention was directed during our life towards this male-female relationship. And therefore, it is said that at the time of death, naturally we think about things that had occupied our consciousness the most. And in this way, we have to take birth again, because these relationships are material, mostly on a material platform. These relationships are based on the concept that we are our bodies. The soul in a man body or in a male body thinks, I am a man and I have to impress this lady now because I am the man. And vice versa, the soul in the female body thinks, I'm a woman and I have to attract this man now with my female attributes and qualities. So both souls in their different bodies, male and female, they are deeply absorbed in the concept that we are these bodies, and we have now this this conjugal exchange. So that is what we can learn here from the purport. And so let me see, I made some notes. From the previous verses we learned from the moth. The moth, who is so attracted to the fire, to the form, flickering form of fire, that the moth comes nearer to the fire, nearer and nearer, and at one point it catches fire, the moth catches fire and is burned. So this is due to the sense of sight, the eyes. The eyes, who are attracted to the object of the eyes, in this case the flickering fire. So here we learn from the elephant. The elephant is not so aroused by the attraction of sight or form, like the moth, like in the case of the moth. No, here the elephant is more aroused or agitated by the sense of touching, the sense of touch. So the male elephant, the he elephant, wants to touch the she elephant, and so he becomes mad due to lust. I want to touch this she elephant, and he's running behind the she elephant in the jungle. So the hunters, those hunters who want to capture or captivate elephants for various reasons. Some they want to sell them, and others use elephants for working. Previously, when there were no tractors or big trucks, people in India or in Africa and other parts of the world, they use elephants for carrying lots of loads. An elephant is really strong. So that might be one reason, or the other one is very unfortunate reason is they want to get those teeth of the elephants, ivory teeth, and sell it and make some furnitures or other things out of it. So they kill those elephants. And maybe a third reason is to bring it to the zoo, and there people like to see the elephants. So in this way, those hunters try to capture an elephant and a he elephant, and they know the easiest way of captivating a male elephant is they train in advance, they train a she elephant that they have already captured. They train this she elephant in a way that the she elephant is somehow attracting the he elephant, and then at one point the he elephant is following the she elephant. But these hunters, they were very smart. In advance, they dug a hole in the ground and put some grass and leaves on top so that the he elephant cannot see that there is a huge big hole in the ground. And at one point, when the he elephant is following with blue eyes the she elephant, it falls into that trap, into this hole, and is captivated. So that is the example that the he elephant is so much agitated by the imagination, I will touch this she elephant, and therefore I want to get this she elephant and follow, therefore I will follow her. Yeah, and that is the instruction we get here from the pages of Srimad Bhagavatam, that a wise spiritualist, he or she should be very careful, especially here it is written from the male perspective, the sadhu, the male sadhu should be very careful in his dealings with women, if he is serious in practicing spiritual life, if he really wants to realize Krishna in the spiritual world and that he is a eternal spiritual soul, then it cannot go hand in hand that simultaneously he is indulging in sexual thoughts, fantasies, what to speak of dealing in a sexual way with women. That is like throwing water into the fire. The spiritual fire cannot burn if we constantly put water, material water inside. So that is a very important instruction that we can learn here. Of course, we should not become fanatics. There are women for sadhus, for sannyasis, for brahmacharis, and those who are very serious in their spiritual practice. Still, women are everywhere. Everywhere we see women. So it is not the solution that we reject women in a fanatical way, but we have to have some healthy distance. We should not be get too near to women in the form of seeing their beautiful forms or, what to speak, touching them. We should be very careful. So this is the instruction for today, and tomorrow we will read text 14. I give you a short teaser. Where are my glasses? Here. And if you have questions, you may ask them now, or you can type them in the comments, and then we can deal with them tomorrow. So the next verse is, a saintly mendicant should not even collect foodstuffs to eat. No, sorry, this is the wrong verse. 14. It goes like, a man possessing intelligent discrimination should not under any circumstances try to exploit the beautiful form of women for his sense gratification. Just as an elephant trying to enjoy a she-elephant is killed by other bull elephants also enjoying her company, one trying to enjoy a lady's company can at any moment be killed by her other lovers who are stronger than he. So, tomorrow again, one of those intense verses of the Srimad Bhagavatam. Please stay tuned and see you tomorrow. Hare Krishna.